It is useful to classify differential equations according to some properties, because the methods that you use to analyze them and to find the solutions depend on these properties. The first distinction is between partial and ordinary. A differential equation is ordinary if it only depends on one variable, like u of x here, and then correspondingly the derivatives in this differential equation are only with respect to this one variable. While if the function depends on more than one variable and you have different derivatives or derivatives with respect to these different variables in it, then it is called a partial differential equation, because the derivatives are partial. Ordinary differential equations are usually easier to solve, and in the following we will focus on these. The next distinction is between linear and nonlinear. A differential equation is called linear if it contains the function and derivatives only linearly. So in this equation, g of x is linear, d of g by dx is linear, and the second derivative is also here in this equation only linear. It does not matter if there are other terms that are nonlinear in the differential equation, like logarithm of x or x squared. Down here you see an example of a nonlinear differential equation, because g of x squared is in this equation, and that is a nonlinear version of g of x. Here on the left side, this derivative is linear, but on the right side, g of x squared is nonlinear. Linear differential equations are easier to solve. There exists a very nice simple theory for it, and it depends a lot on the superposition principle. So if you have solutions, combinations of these solutions are again solutions of this differential equation. If you have a linear differential equation, another useful distinction is between homogeneous and inhomogeneous. Here you see two linear differential equations, and please note that I use the shorthand notation for derivatives here, namely p dash dash or p dash for the second and the first derivative respectively. These are almost identical, and they differ only in the three here. All the other terms contain the p linearly, which makes these linear differential equations. And the difference is now between homogeneous and inhomogeneous that the homogeneous differential equation only has terms with p in it, or with a function in it, while inhomogeneous differential equations have one other term that does not contain the function under consideration. This distinction will again be useful for the superposition principle, namely the way you can combine solutions of linear differential equations. Another distinction is between autonomous and non-autonomous. This distinction relates to the property whether the independent variable is explicitly in the differential equation or not. And here you see the two different equations, which are very similar, except for the t. T is the independent variable, and in the upper equation, it only appears as the argument of r, while in the lower equation, it appears explicitly. And that makes this equation non-autonomous. An important implication of a differential equation being autonomous is that its solution is shift invariant. So if you have a solution, you can shift it around in the direction of the independent variable. This is because the differential equation, the autonomous differential equation, does not contain t explicitly, so it only refers to t as a relative time marker and not as an absolute time marker. The non-autonomous differential equation contains t explicitly, so it makes a difference whether you start at 0 or at 100. Because a differential equation has a 0 on the right side at t equals 0 and a 300 on the right side for t equals 100. And that makes a difference for the differential equation, for the solution to this differential equation. So autonomous differential equations have solutions that you can shift in the direction of the independent variable, while non-autonomous ones are locked to the exact time where you found the solution. Autonomous differential equations are easier to solve in general. So far, we have only considered single differential equations for one function. But one can also consider several functions and several differential equations, like the example that you see here. So here we have P2 and P1, and they interact through these two differential equations. In such a case, one speaks of a system of differential equations. Another important notion is the order of a differential equation, which corresponds to the highest derivative. This dE, for instance, is of order 3 because we have a third order derivative here and no higher one. It is interesting to note that any higher order differential equation can be converted into a system of first order differential equations, like shown down here. This system is equivalent to the third order differential equation that we see up here. We've introduced two auxiliary functions here. One is Q2, which corresponds to Q dot. Then Q3, which corresponds to Q2 dot, which is Q dot dot. And then if you write Q3 dot here, that effectively is Q dot dot dot. And then we complement this to the differential equation that we have here. These two systems are completely equivalent. This is interesting because once you have a theory for systems of first order differential equations, you can solve any higher order differential equation with that theory. For such systems of differential equations, it is convenient to write them in vector notation, like shown here, where Q is the vector of functions Q, Q2, Q3, and f of Q represents our differential equation, namely the entries on the right side, which in this case would be Q2, Q3, and omega Q.